the Knights of Carrash, the 30th degree of the Scottish Rite Freemasonry. Nine gentlemen of noble birth in 1128, including Geoffrey de St. Aldemar and Frenchman Hugues de Payne, ostensibly to guard pilgrims to the Holy Land, Pope Eugenius III and St. Bernard, sanctioned and chartered and gave the okay to this pious and chivalrous band. Princes of sovereign houses and lords of distinguished families did join, bringing wealth and prestige and political power and a heaping helping of gold coins. In 1150, they kicked some ass on the so-called infidels. Then dissension with the Hospitallers caused the Pope to say, let's sit a spell. A sit-down in mafioso jargon, but centuries before P2, and the Vatican bankers Emanuela Orlandi, Lee Schogeli, and the crew. The Templars were known as the baddest and bravest, and their piety undenied. Just the appearance of the Templar banner made the enemy run and hide. But the Templars and Hospitallers, like the Crips and the Bloods, never could see eye to eye. At best, they formed an uneasy alliance when forced to ride side by side. Fast forward now to 1301 and Pope Boniface III, in conflict with the King of France, known as Philip le Bel, the Turd, who said the Pope had no jurisdiction in the kingdom known as France. The Templars came to the Church's aid with their fortune and a lance. Boniface died in 1303, succeeded by Benedict, who 8 months later died as well, leaving Peter's chair derelict. As a year went by with no consensus from the cardinals divided into two factions, one loyal to King Philip and the other to Cardinal Francis Guyton, who was the nephew of Pope Boniface, with a mutual hatred to France. The two sides agreed for the good of the church to let a third suitor cut in on the dance. Three archbishops were nominated by Cardinal Francis Guyton, thinking all to be faithful to him. The first on the list was Archbishop of Bordeaux, whose Christian name was Bernard de Guette. A good friend to Guyton, but fond of pleasure and ambitious to a fault, the opposing faction's leader, Cardinal Dupré, sent a courier to call. Knowing his weakness like an astrology chart and sworn to secrecy, he told De Guette, I will make you the Pope if you'll promise 6 favors to me. The first 5 conditions I'll reveal to you now, but the 6th when you take Peter's seat, to which the Archbishop Bernie sat up and salivated like a hungry dog begging for meat. He was installed at the College of Cardinals and Lions and took the papal name Clement V, and learned the heads of the Templars on a silver platter was King Philip's condition the 6th. And he bobbed and he weaved and he tried to back out, but the king says, you're pretty mistress, that twists your nipples while you lick her feet and all manners of avarice. She's hot and she's sweet and she's kinky and cool, Perigard's most luscious countess. How she grows with desire at the power of Pope Clement the base and corruptible impostor pontiff. Are you telling me Jesus conspired with power to betray his nobility? You're just a weak fucking junkie who'll do any damn thing, including perverse sexuality. This ain't 30 shekels of the Sadducees' silver into which you will dip your beak, but the vastest of fortunes of international bankers that will split between you and me. And so summoned was Grandmaster Jacques de Molay, where he was graciously received, in the court of the Pope, who hid his true motives like an ace of spades up his frilly little sleeve. And in fairness to Clement, he proposed a crusade with the Hospitallers at their side, perhaps trying to get them out of harm's way, or perhaps betrayal and murder he tried. Like when the mob says, go with Joey down to Florida and you know it'll be your last ride. When you know it's your rival and the Godfather makes you an offer you can't brush aside. Keep in mind that the Hospitallers would be bequeathed Templar property that would be divvied up as ill-gotten gains of the pontiff and the king. The Grand Master declined on logistical grounds of impracticality, and remember, my friends, that outside of the Pope himself, they bowed to no authority. Such was the power of the Knights Templar in 1307 CE, and his military frankness was coupled with the spirit of religious piety. But then charges were leveled by 2 wretched prisoners that King Philip put up to the crime, of bearing false witness against the Templars, of theft and homicide, idolatry, sodomy, trampling the cross, and the worship of Baphomet, perhaps Muhammad, and for their false testimony they were pardoned and sent on their way. The king sent these accusations to the Pope, who said, get the fuck out of my face. It was 9 July 1307, and the charge is too general and debased. But on Friday, the 13th day of October, from whence the superstition came, on the orders of King Philip, all the Templars in the region were arrested and imprisoned that day. Some said it was that they stirred up sedition in Paris, or supported Pope Boniface. But really they knew it was greedy King Philip trumping up charges to confiscate. The exceeding wealth of this pious order, who did secretly excavate, to the Chamber of Nine in the Temple of Solomon, learning secrets inviolate. Like the secret gnosis of the earliest Christians in the sacred geometry, of the sun and the moon and the stars and the planets and of our own true divinity, that doesn't require a priest or a king or any intermediary, but is revealed by a way of initiation to those who have eyes to see. When Edward II learned of the arrests, he emailed the Pope at once, and all the kings and queens in Europe, and said, don't be too quick to judge, or what a bunch of bogus crap. We all know these are soldiers of Christ. They may have made some powerful enemies, but I know they are square and upright. But the king appointed an inquisitor, William de Nogaret. But Clement said, hey, Philip, you don't have jurisdiction to persecute this case. The king grabbed his testes and said, jurisdict this. And the Pope left with egg on his face, to the arms of his mistress in his ill-gotten palace with a bottle of Beaujolais. And the torture of the Templars yielded not a confession through the broken bones and white-hot prods, at least for a while, till some finally broke down and admitted to shitting on God, or fixing the Ali Norton fight, or whatever would stop the pain. Pope Clement himself obtained 72 confessions, but couldn't break Master Jacques de Molay. Though they crucified him on a heavy door that just for laughs they could open and slam, and covered his face with a white linen cloth that some swear is the Shroud of Turin. Again and again they swore their innocence, but their cries fell on deaf, hard ears, and kings and princes wrote on the Templars' behalf, but the Pope never answered their queries. They were taken to Paris, they revoked their confessions, and the original charges now stood. They were given the choice of a light prison term or a slow roasting pile of wood. With the sign of the cross, de Molay protested that the charges were blasphemous lies, and the written contents of the alleged confessions was false witness multiplied, that to perpetrate this nightmare on such a pious order like scheming demons dressed in kingly guise, a more devious display of sinister forces had never been devised, at least since the Christ was crucified. Nowhere, save the cathedral churches themselves, was the Mass celebrated with greater devotion than in Templar cathedrals of magnificent masonry filled with relics from across the ocean. We give alms to the poor 3 times a week and not just an old can of beans, and we've given our blood up to the horse's bridle in defense of the Holy See. We believe firmly in the Father and Son and the Holy Trinity and the priests and the nuns and the little bambinos and the rule of the papacy. But all was prejudged, and the Pope's commissioners proceeded accordingly. Those who confessed were given a penance, a pat on the rear, and set free. 59 were taken out the gate of St. Antoine and burned alive in a slow-roasting fire, all invoking the holy name of God, professing innocence down to the wire. On May 22, 1312, the Order of the Templars was quashed. Due process was far from the order of the day, with expedience the record awash. By apostolic authority, their property seized, castles and gold for the good rebel Jesus. The knavish, unprincipled Pope Clement V, awash with murderous fraud most grievous. Then the Pope sent cardinals to try de Molay, whose rank equaled that of a prince, along with the priors, lieutenants of the order, who, though imprisoned, continued to resist. Many people were outraged, so they staged a mock trial, which was more like a grand inquisition. Declare your innocence and die burning in fire, or recant and die slowly in prison. The church's legate opened with a harangue expounding improprieties and abominations. Then he cited confessions already revoked as persuasive corroboration. Then he offered full pardons if they'd elocute every blasphemous insult to God, with the wood being stacked and the terror profuse. That's duress. That's constructive fraud. I confess to the worship of goats and the scat-singing fetish therein, and to dancing a jig on the Holy Cross into all forms of avarice and sin. We drink the blood of Christian children screaming naked young girls. I'll tell you whatever you want to hear if you set me free and not condemn me to burn. The priors of France and of Aquitaine confess to the long list of crimes. De Molay stepped forward rattling heavy chains and declared this an evil pack of lies. It is very right that on this terrible day in the last moments of my life, I should uncover all the iniquity and expose the unholy lie. I declare then before the heavens and earth, and I avow to my eternal shame, that my greatest crime, for whatever it's worth, has been to attach my honor and name to those foully charged against an order truly pious and innocent, that force my declaration for respite from torture that in agony I did confess. But the fearful spectacle that confronts me now shall not compound lie upon lie. Upon a condition so infamous, I renounce this hateful life. For what would avail me to live one more second on foundation of the basest slander, at which point the guards did gag him and seize him in a pig-headed, boorish manner?